currency. They use the euro. You got to point a finger at the ECB. But be that as it may, Trump has painted with a very broad brush and said that, you know, Mexico, Germany, Japan, China, and others have cheap currencies, and that's how they promote exports and cost Americans jobs. Of course, this is, you know, currency wars 101. It's what I wrote about in my first book, currency wars a few years ago, and I said at the time that they would continue for a long period of time, meaning 15 or 20 years. That book came out in 2011, so I'm not the least bit surprised. Here we are in 2017. Not only are we still talking about currency wars, they're actually more urgent than ever because Trump's the president. He's making a point of it. Okay, so just take everything I said in the last 5 minutes. Trump complained that interest rates were too low, and he might appoint hawks, but he thinks the dollar is too strong, and he wants a weaker dollar. Well, what happens when you raise interest rates? It makes the dollar stronger. It pushes in the opposite direction from a weaker dollar, which is what Trump says he wants. So there's a basic contradiction there. You can't have it both ways. You can't have hawks raising interest rates and a cheap dollar at the same time, because higher rates make the dollar more attractive, money comes in, and the dollar gets stronger. So that's one problem. Let's just take another issue, something called the border transaction tax. Now, what is this? This is something designed to promote exports and reduce imports, which would, in theory, reduce the U.S. trade deficit, help growth, and create U.S. jobs in our export industries and make it perhaps more attractive to manufacture in the United States instead of Mexico and China. Well, this is being pushed by Peter Navarro, Dan D'Amico, and some of the other, Robert Lighthizer, who is the designated U.S. trade representative, and some of the other inner circle members of Trump's team. Okay, but what does it mean when you put tariffs on? And the way this would work is you would tax imports with something like a tariff, and the cost of imports would not be tax deductible. So if you're a U.S. manufacturer and you import components, whatever you spend on those imported components, you can't deduct from your taxes. So in effect, it increases the cost of imports to a U.S. taxpayer. Likewise, if you export stuff, the revenue from the exports is not taxable income. You don't have to pay any tax on that. So you lose your tax deduction on the cost of imports. You get a tax exemption on the proceeds from exports. And the combination of the two promotes exports, hurts imports. It acts like a tariff on imports, in effect, is what it is. Well, there's another identity in economics, which is that savings equals investment in the aggregate. So what happens when U.S. savings, domestic savings, are less than our investment, which they are right now? We the United States invests, we spend more on investment, whether it's, you know, housing or capital goods or, you know, other forms of infrastructure or long-term goods. We spend more on investment than we save. The U.S. doesn't save enough. Well, where does the difference come from? It comes from abroad. It comes from overseas. Foreigners invest dollars in our economy, and that's how we make up the shortfall between domestic savings and investment. Well, where do the foreigners get the dollars? They get it from running a trade surplus with the United States, because they sell us stuff and we give them dollars, and then they take the dollars and invest it back here. So there's an identity there, which is the shortfall between domestic savings and investments is exactly equal to the trade surplus of foreigners with the United States. It just has to be, because that's where the dollars come from. They don't come from Mars. Well, when you increase the cost of imports, in other words, when you put a tariff on or you do something like this border tax adjustment that we talked about, and you increase the cost of exports, if that were the only thing happening, that would reduce our trade deficit, but then where would the foreigners get the money to make up the investment gap in the United States? And they have to. So the way that works out is that the dollar gets stronger. In other words, the stronger dollar offsets the impact of the tariffs. So my imported goods could be French wine, you know, a nice German pair of skis, a Japanese car, you know, whatever it is, you know, Chinese textiles, clothes you buy at Costco from Thailand, whatever it is. If the price of that goes up because of tariffs, the dollar has to get stronger so that the real price doesn't change at all. In other words, my stronger dollar offsets the impact of the tariff. Well, once again, and that's how you adjust this global savings versus trade surplus identity that I described earlier. So bottom line, I'll skip the economics lecture, but the bottom line is tariffs all things equal, make the dollar stronger, because that's how you offset the impact of the tariffs and maintain the foreign trade surplus that gets invested in the United States. So once again, there's a contradiction. Trump says he wants a weaker dollar, but tariffs would actually make the dollar stronger. There are other solutions, including a collapse of investment, so that you close the savings investment gap by shrinking investment, but that would just throw the U.S. economy into a recession. Nobody wants that. So once again, we have Trump calling for a policy, which is tariffs or border tax adjustments on imports that would make the dollar stronger, and at the same time, he wants the dollar to be weaker. So the reason I'm going through all this in a lot of detail is just to make the point that taken individually, these policies may have something to offer or may not. You know, you may disagree with them, but collectively, they don't add up, and something's going to break. And what I expect is that the solution to this tariff savings shortfall issue that I just described is inflation. In other words, if the dollar just gets stronger, that is by itself deflationary, but what if you generate inflation through easier monetary policy? You know, as we run larger deficits, the Fed accommodates the deficits. Well, that is helicopter money. That's what helicopter money is. We get inflation, and now you may find that the nominal value of imports is going up, but the real value isn't, because a lot of it's just inflation. You'd have a stronger dollar from imports, but you'd have a weaker dollar from monetary policy, and on net, you'd probably get inflation through higher import prices, and that would be through the supply chain, et cetera. So once again, I come back to gold. In other words, I can describe all this. I could give an economics lecture on it. I can't predict exactly how it's going to turn out. I can tell you that not all these things will happen, because they contradict each other. The tariff thing flies in the face of a weak dollar. The Fed hawks fly in the face of a weak dollar. So you'll probably get Fed doves, a weaker dollar. You'll probably get tariffs too, but they'll solve that with inflation, and all roads lead to gold. By the way, this is why gold is going up. Gold has gone up 10% in the past 6 weeks, from the middle of December until now, actually 7 weeks. Gold has gone up 10%, but the reason it has gone up 10% is because people look at, expert traders look at the issues I'm describing, and they say, you know, there's only one way out of this. There's only one way to get to debt sustainability. There's only one way to, you know, kind of have larger deficits, if that's what Trump wants, which is inflation. And so people are getting out ahead of that. I think smaller investors should understand that this move in gold is not a normal blip. It's not normal volatility. It's actually being driven by a very fundamental understanding of the contradictions in Trump's economic policies. And, you know, a lot of people remember election night when initially when the returns were coming in, it became more and more apparent that Trump was going to win. Initially, the price of gold was soaring. It went up, you know, well over, went up to about 1330, 1340 an ounce. It was a huge surge. And then it just hit an air pocket and went straight down, all the way down to, I think, 1150 was the low in mid-December. Well, why was that? Well, one reason was because, in a very public way, Stan Druckenmiller sold all of his gold. Stan Druckenmiller, prior to the election, was one of the biggest bulls on gold, acquired a very large gold position, some paper, some physical, in Duquesne Capital, which is his family office kind of slash hedge fund. It's not an open hedge fund. It's really a family office at this point. And when Druckenmiller saw that Trump was going to win, he said, well, I was buying gold because I was worried about Hillary. Now that Trump won, I dumped all my gold. Well, people found out about that. They go, oh, well, Stan's out of gold. I'm getting out of gold. And people sold their ETFs. And, you know, this whole thing got a momentum, and gold went all the way down to, as I say, to around the 1150 range. Well, guess who's back? Stan Druckenmiller is now buying gold. In other words, he's looking, now that the Trump trade and the Trump euphoria are over, he's looking at what I just described. He's looking at these contradictions and saying, you know, Trump really does want a weak dollar, and he's in a position to get it because of his Fed appointments. And a weak dollar means a higher dollar price for gold, so it's a great time to buy gold. So he's back in the market. Other people are getting tuned into this. This is why gold's rallying. I would expect that rally to continue.
So one of the things I'm hearing you say, Jim, is that basically all roads right now are leading to inflation, which means also that all roads are sort of leading to gold as well. I'd like to turn for a moment and talk about some core concepts. Now, when I say core concepts, I mean the type of thing that, you and I have discussed for years now that many of the regular listeners of our podcasts are aware of. For people who are new to this podcast and new to the things that we're talking about, I recommend you go back and take a look at Jim's first book, Currency Wars, and kind of try to bring yourself current. But one of the most interesting things that we've discussed since I've known you, Jim, you've described capital markets as complex systems. And this is a view I've come to agree with. Why are capital markets complex systems? Could you talk a little bit about why that is? And for analysts using measurements such as VAR and other traditional tools, why does this matter?
Well, let me give you a fairly succinct version of that, Alex. As a lot of topics, I could deliver a 2 or 3 hour lecture on that, and I have, but let me give you the short version. The question is, are capital markets complex systems? I actually think that's the most important question in economics today, and here's why. Because there's a difference between complexity and complicated. People use those two words interchangeably, but and that's fine in terms of everyday conversation, but in scientific terms, they mean very different things, and I'll explain why. But the models that are in use today by central banks, by Wall Street, by risk managers, et cetera, fall into one of two categories. They're either equilibrium models, which assume that, you know, you have efficient markets, good pricing information, people are rational, they're wealth maximizers, they act rationally, and so the economy really works like a well-tuned Swiss watch. And just in case it gets out of tune, every now and then there's something economists call hysteresis, but basically something comes along and disturbs the equilibrium, so it's like your watch needs to be wound up, you know, it's running slow or whatever. But all the central banks have to do is come along, put a little pressure in the opposite direction, tip it back into balance, and then it's like winding the watch. All of a sudden, it's running like a Swiss watch again. It's keeping very good time. So an equilibrium model more or less takes care of itself. Everything balances out, but just in case it gets out of balance for whatever reason, you can tip it back into balance. That's the equilibrium model. The other model of risk management is that events in capital markets, when I say events, I mean price goes up, price goes down, normal fluctuation or extreme fluctuation, panics, et cetera, that what's called the degree distribution, which is how do you compare the frequency and the severity? How often do really severe things happen? How often do really small little things happen? What's the extent of both of those things on, you know, just imagine an X and a Y axis, a normal grid, where the vertical Y axis is the frequency of the event and the horizontal X axis is the severity of the event. The assumption is that it looks like a bell curve, and a bell curve is a kind of a smoothly downward sloping curve from upper left to lower right, where the small events happen all the time, so you have high frequency, low impact, and then the extreme events happen almost never at all, so by the time you get way out to the right on the x-axis, which are the really extreme events, the curve has come down and made a nice soft landing on the axis itself. In other words, the frequency is close to zero. So extreme events never happen or happen very, very, very rarely, and common events happen all the time. That's what's called a normal distribution, also known as the bell curve. And that's the assumption behind a lot of risk management modeling, including value at risk, which is the major model. So you've got these two assumptions. One, equilibrium models. Two, normally distributed risk. Both of those things are empirically wrong, meaning it's not my opinion. You can actually look at data. You can actually look at the degree distribution of shocks and events in capital markets. You can actually look behind the operation, the system dynamics, in other words, the capital markets. And you can see that empirically and analytically, those two models that the central banks and Wall Street use do not correspond to reality. Well, that's pretty bad. If you have the wrong model, it's like thinking the sun revolves around the earth. You know, we all know that the earth revolves around the sun, but for 1,000 years or longer, people thought that the sun revolved around the earth. Well, try flying to the moon if you think the sun revolves around the earth. You're going to fail. In other words, if you have the wrong model, you'll get bad results every time. And this is why central banks and the IMF and BIS and others never see recessions coming. They never see panics coming. They never see anything like 2008 coming. They never see it coming because they have the wrong models. Now, what's the correct model? And this gets back to your question on complexity theory. So imagine we were enrolling in the physics department at, you know, the University of Michigan or MIT or, you know, some fine school that with a professor who knew nothing about economics. So we wanted to go into physics, the physics department, and we wanted to study complexity theory, and we were being taught by somebody who didn't know anything about capital markets. What would they teach us? In other words, what would they say a complex system is? They would say it has four main parts or four main characteristics. You look for these four things in determining whether a system is complex or not. And the four things are diversity, connectedness, interaction, and adaptive behavior. So DCIA, just diversity, connectedness, interaction, and adaptive behavior. Let's take them one at a time. In any system, you have what are called agents. Agents are just the individual actors. They could be an agent could be, in effect, a molecule or an atom. If you're talking about a radioactive element, it could be a person. If you're talking about getting stuck in traffic or trading, buying and selling stocks, right? So whether it's subatomic or at the human level, whatever the individual actors in the system, they're agents. Well, the first thing you need is diversity of agents. If everybody acts the same and thinks the same and responds the same, it's not a complex system because there's nothing, there's no clashing, there's no divergence of opinion. There's nothing to create unexpected outcomes. The second thing you need, so imagine it's just a bunch of cave people, right? We have a primitive society. We're all living in caves. If every one of those cave people thought exactly the same thing about everything, that's a really boring system. That's not a complex system. But if you have different points of view, now you have the beginnings of a complex system. The second thing is connectedness. So we've got agents, actors in the system. They have different points of view. But are they connected somehow? Can they find each other? Well, if not, then again, it's really boring. Everyone just sits in his cave and thinks what they think, but there's no action. But in fact, if you all come out of your cave and sit around a campfire and get into a discussion at night, well, okay, now you have connectedness. Third thing, interaction. So we're diverse, we think differently, we're connected. Are we doing anything? Are we transacting in any way? And then the fourth thing is adaptive behavior, which is, my behavior affects your behavior affects my behavior. We change what we do based on what we observe other people doing. So again, to go back to my caveman analogy, so the diverse caveman, they come sit around the fire, they're communicating, they interact, they all decide to go out and hunt for mastodon the next day, but one caveman goes in a different direction and everyone else gets food and he doesn't. So he's like, you know what, I better adapt my behavior, I better go with these other guys tomorrow because I'll get some food for my family. So there's my caveman example of illustrating those four things. So let's just take those four things and you can apply them to physical elements, earthquakes, sunspots, forest fires. I mean, there are many, many examples of complex systems. Let's just take what I just described and apply it to capital markets. Do we have diverse actors? Of course we do. We have bulls and bears, fear and greed, long and short, leveraged, non-leveraged. You can get 10 opinions on every stock or bond or commodity you want to mention. So, yes, we have very diverse actors. Are they connected? Absolutely. We have Thomson Reuters, we have Dow Jones, we have Bloomberg, we have chat rooms, we have telephones, email, CNBC, we're podcasts. We're probably over-connected, but yes, we're certainly connected. Are we interacting? Big time. Trillions of dollars of stocks, bonds, currency, commodity transactions taking place every single day, every single minute. We're transacting in massive scale, interacting. And finally, the last question is, do we have adaptive behavior? Well, of course we do. I mean, I just gave an example. Stan Druckenmiller sold all his gold on election night. Well, as soon as people found out, so did they. Everyone else went out and sold their gold. So, of course, we have adaptive behavior. So we're four for four. In other words, the four key pillars of complexity theory taught to you or me by someone who knew nothing about capital markets, when applied to capital markets, reveal that capital markets are complex systems, nonpareil. They're not only complex systems. They're one of the most complex, best examples you can think of a complex system. Well, okay, fine. What does that mean? I mean, is it just, it's an interesting lecture, but what's the significance of it? The significance is that risk or events in complex systems are not normally distributed. They're distributed according to a different curve called a power curve, not a bell curve. And it's not just an argument about the shape of two different curves. Those curves are just manifestations of events in the real world which have a completely different characteristic, different reaction functions, different frequencies, different severities. Everything about it is different. So the minute you sort of go through the looking glass and say, well, capital markets are not complicated systems with normally distributed events. They're actually complex systems with events distributed along a power curve. you have entered a completely different risk profile, a completely different way of understanding the world. And that's what I do in my own analysis. Those are the models I use. But the point being, if you're stuck in the failed, incorrect, obsolete view that, you know, risk is normally distributed and systems operate in a kind of complicated equilibrium, you are going to miss everything. You're going to miss every turning point. You're going to miss every crisis. You're going to lose money. You're going to get wiped out every 7 or 8 years. On the other hand, if you can embrace complexity theory, understand it, apply it, and see that the risks are far greater than Wall Street tells us, and that the worst thing that can happen is exponentially greater than Wall Street believes, and that the frequency is a function of scale, and the scale keeps getting bigger, which means the frequency of the severe events gets exponentially bigger, you'd be scared to death. I mean, you look at the system we've got and say, well, you know, it may not break down tomorrow, but actually it could, and you could get completely wiped out. This is another reason to have gold in your portfolio, because gold will withstand these extreme events much better than other kinds of financial assets.
Outstanding. I love the caveman analogy. That's really great. And as far as all these indicators that most financial professionals are basing what they're doing on is really based upon false assumptions. It's kind of like, to me, it's kind of like being in an airplane. You've got all these indicators, but they're feeding you information off of false data. And as you mentioned, that is a pretty scary situation. We have a little bit of time left. We have one question from one of our listeners that we wanted to go to. We like to try to do as much listener interaction as possible. So for those of you who want to ask questions for the podcast, you can always submit them by email to us at our website. Or if you want, you can just ask directly on Twitter. We get those, and when we can, we include them. This question is coming. This is a Twitter question. It's coming from a Twitter user by the name of Absolute Hokies. It's an interesting handle there. His question is, in reference to Triffin's dilemma, and as it relates to the border adjustment tax, repatriation of funds, Fed hikes. His question is, doesn't BAT repatriation counter Triffin's dilemma forces that are regarding dollar movement? And if so, does a stronger dollar worsen the debt crisis?
Well, it's a compound question, and I spent a little bit of time talking about the impact of the border adjustment tax, but what I said was that if you impose it, it's a kind of tariff, and the reaction function would either be a collapse of investment because there wouldn't be enough of a foreign surplus to fund the investment deficit, and so investment would collapse, which would put the U.S. economy into a recession, which would be deflationary, or the dollar would get stronger to offset the higher import prices so that the foreign surplus could be just as big so they could fund our investment shortfall. But either way, you either end up with deflation or a stronger dollar, which offsets the deflationary impact of a stronger dollar offsets the inflationary impact of the tariff, and so the combination of the two is net neutral. It doesn't really go to Triffin's dilemma. Triffin's dilemma, just for the benefit of the listeners, it goes back to the early 1960s. It was named after an economist, Belgian economist named Robert Triffin, and what he said was that when a country issues the global reserve currency. And, of course, that is the situation with the United States. It was then. It is today. Right today, dollars, U.S. dollars, are 80% of global payments, 60% of global reserves. So it's the dominant global reserve currency. The world needs dollars to conduct transactions. It needs dollars to pay each other. It needs dollars to hold its savings, et cetera. And where do they get them? They get them from the U.S. trade deficit. If the U.S. ran a trade surplus, what would we be doing? We'd be sucking up all the dollars in the world. It's only by running a deficit that we spread dollars around the world. Other countries earn the dollars from us, and then they have dollars to buy oil or buy stuff in the United States or invest or whatever they need. So Triffin's dilemma said, if you run a global reserve currency, you also have to run persistent deficits. If you don't, the world won't have enough of your currency for commerce to grow. But if you run persistent deficits, eventually you'll go broke. In other words, the dilemma was the thing that you need to do to supply the world with dollars will eventually cause you to go bankrupt because your deficits will catch up to you. Now, he said this in 1960. It's turning out to be true. It took, 55 years to play out, and there were a lot of strong dollar, weak dollar episodes along the way, but the bottom line is what Triffin predicted 55 years ago is playing out today, which is that the U.S. is going broke, our debt is non-sustainable, and we're getting closer and closer to a dollar crisis every day. So that's Triffin's dilemma. Now, the border adjustment tax doesn't really affect that one way or the other because, as I explained, the higher import prices, well, I think what the listener was getting to, I don't want to put words in anyone's mouth, but I think what the listener was getting at is if you have a border tax adjustment, doesn't that reduce the trade deficit and doesn't that solve Triffin's dilemma? And the answer is no, not if you get a stronger dollar as a result, because the higher price of imports is offset by the stronger dollar, meaning you get more for your buck. And so the trade deficit for the U.S. and the external trade surplus in dollars is the same. In other words, the exchange rate adjusts to offset the impact of the tariff, and so the net effect on the deficit or surplus is the same, and therefore there's no impact on Triffin's dilemma. But that said, the whole issue with Triffin's dilemma is coming to a head. The solution to Triffin's dilemma is not the U.S. trade deficit or surplus, it's the SDR, the special drawing right, because the SDR is a form of world money that's issued by the IMF, and the IMF is not a country. The IMF doesn't have a trade deficit or a trade surplus because it's not a country. It just pulls the money out of thin air. So for foreigners to get dollars from the U.S., they have to earn them by running a trade surplus with the United States. That means we have a deficit. That's Triffin's dilemma. But for foreigners to get SDRs, they don't have to do anything. They just have to wait for a phone call from Christine Lagarde, and she says, here's your SDRs. So the real solution to Triffin's dilemma is the SDR, but the impact of that is certainly inflationary, which in my view is one more reason to own gold.
Very good. All right, Jim, I want to thank you for your time. It's been an excellent discussion, and thank you to all of our loyal listeners. John?
Yeah, thank you, Jim Rickards. Fascinating new material, and thank you, Alex. It's always a pleasure and an education sharing this time with the both of you. And most of all, thank you to our listeners for spending time with us today. Let me encourage you to follow Jim and Alex on Twitter. Jim's handle is at James G. Rickards. Alex's handle is at Alex Stanzik. And if you've enjoyed this podcast, please recommend it to your friends. If you're watching on YouTube, please click like and subscribe. And if you're listening on iTunes, please give us a rating and a review. So goodbye for now to everyone, and we look forward to joining you again soon. You have been listening to The Gold Chronicles, Jim Rickards and Alex Stanzik, presented by Physical Gold Fund. Recordings can be found at physicalgoldfund.com/podcasts. You can register there for news of upcoming interviews with Jim Rickards and other world-class thinkers.
Representative and some of the other inner circle members of Trump's team. Okay, but what does it mean when you put tariffs on? And the way this would work is you would tax imports with something like a tariff, but the cost of imports would not be tax deductible. So if you're a U.S. manufacturer and you import components, whatever you spend on those imported components, you can't deduct from your taxes. So in effect, it increases the cost of imports to a U.S. taxpayer. Likewise, if you export stuff, the revenue from the exports is not taxable income. You don't have to pay any tax on that. So you lose your tax deduction on the cost of imports. You get a tax exemption on the proceeds from exports, and the combination of the two promotes exports, hurts imports. It acts like a tariff on imports, in effect, is what it is. Well, there's another identity in economics, which is that savings equals investment in the aggregate. So what happens when U.S. savings, domestic savings, are less than our investment, which they are right now? We the United States invests, we spend more on investment, whether it's, you know, housing or capital goods or, you know, other forms of infrastructure or long-term goods. We spend more on investment than we save. The U.S. doesn't save enough. Well, where does the difference come from? It comes from abroad. It comes from overseas. Foreigners invest dollars in our economy, and that's how we make up the shortfall between domestic savings and investment. Well, where do the foreigners get the dollars? They get it from running a trade surplus with the United States because they sell us stuff and we give them dollars and then they take the dollars and invest it back here. So there's an identity there, which is the shortfall between domestic savings and investments is exactly equal to the trade surplus that would make the dollar stronger, and at the same time he wants the dollar to be weaker. So the reason I'm going through all this in a lot of detail is just to make the point that taken individually, these policies may have something to offer or may not. You know, you may disagree with them, but collectively they don't add up, and something's going to break. And what I expect is that the solution to this tariff saving shortfall issue that I just described is inflation. In other words, if the dollar just gets stronger, that is by itself deflationary, but what if you generate inflation through easier monetary policy? You know, as we run larger deficits, the Fed accommodates the deficits. Well, that is helicopter money. That's what helicopter money is. We get inflation, and now you may find that the nominal value of imports is going up, but the real value isn't, because a lot of it's just inflation. You'd have a stronger dollar from imports, but you'd have a weaker dollar from monetary policy, and on net, you'd probably get inflation through higher import prices, and that would be through the supply chain, et cetera. So once again, I come back to gold. In other words, I can describe all this. I could give an economics lecture on it. I can't predict exactly how it's going to turn out. I can tell you that not all these things will happen because they contradict each other. The tariff thing flies in the face of a weak dollar. The Fed hawks fly in the face of a weak dollar. So you'll probably get Fed doves, a weaker dollar. You'll probably get tariffs too, but they'll solve that with inflation, and all roads lead to gold. By the way, this is why gold is going up. Gold has gone up 10% in the past 6 weeks, from the middle of December until now, actually 7 weeks. Gold has gone up 10%, but the reason it has gone up 10% is because people look at, expert traders look at the issues I'm describing, and they say, you know, there's only one way out of this. There's only one way to get to debt sustainability. There's only one way to, you know, kind of have larger deficits, if that's what Trump wants, which is inflation. And so people are getting out ahead of that. I think smaller investors should understand that this move in gold is not a normal blip. It's not normal volatility. It's actually being driven by a very fundamental understanding of the contradictions in Trump's economic policies. And, you know, a lot of people remember election night when initially when the returns were coming in, it became more and more apparent that Trump was going to win. Initially, the price of gold was soaring. It went up, you know, well over, went up to about 1330, 1340 an ounce. It was a huge surge. And then it just hit an air pocket and went straight down, all the way down to, I think, 1150 was the low in mid-December. Well, why was that? Well, one reason was because, in a very public way, Stan Druckenmiller sold all of his gold. Stan Druckenmiller, prior to the election, was one of the biggest bulls on gold, acquired a very large gold position, some paper, some physical, in Duquesne Capital, which is his family office, kind of slash hedge fund. It's not an open hedge fund. It's really a family office at this point. And when Druckenmiller saw that Trump was going to win, he said, well, I was buying gold because I was worried about Hillary. Now that Trump won, I dumped all my gold. Well, people found out about that and go, oh, well, Stan's out of gold. I'm getting out of gold. And people sold their ETFs. And, you know, this whole thing got a momentum, and gold went all the way down to, as I say, to around the 1150 range. Well, guess who's back? Stan Druckenmiller is now buying gold. In other words, he's looking, now that the Trump trade and the Trump euphoria are currency, they use the euro. You got to point a finger at the ECB. But be that as it may, Trump has painted with a very broad brush and said that, you know, Mexico, Germany, Japan, China, and others have cheap currencies, and that's how they promote exports and cost Americans jobs. Of course, this is, you know, currency wars 101. It's what I wrote about in my first book, currency wars, a few years ago, and I said at the time that they would continue for a long period of time, meaning 15 or 20 years. That book came out in 2011, so I'm not the least bit surprised. Here we are in 2017. Not only are we still talking about currency wars, they're actually more urgent than ever because Trump's the president. He's making a point of it. Okay, so just take everything I said in the last 5 minutes. Trump complains that interest rates were too low, and he might appoint hawks, but he thinks the dollar is too strong, and he wants a weaker dollar. Well, what happens when you raise interest rates? It makes the dollar stronger. It pushes in the opposite direction from a weaker dollar, which is what Trump says he wants. So there's a basic contradiction there. You can't have it both ways. You can't have hawks raising interest rates and a cheap dollar at the same time, because higher rates make the dollar more attractive, money comes in, and the dollar gets stronger. So that's one problem. Let's just take another issue, something called the border transaction adjustment, or border transaction tax. Now, what is this? This is something designed to promote exports and reduce imports, which would, in theory, reduce the U.S. trade deficit, help growth, and create U.S. jobs in our export industries, and make it perhaps more attractive to manufacture in the United States instead of Mexico and China. Well, this is being pushed by Peter Navarro, Dan D'Amico, and some of the other, Robert Lighthizer, who's the designated U.S. trade plus of foreigners with the United States. It just has to be, because that's where the dollars come from. They don't come from Mars. Well, when you increase the cost of imports, in other words, when you put a tariff on, or you do something like this border tax adjustment that we talked about, and you increase the cost of exports, if that were the only thing happening, that would reduce our trade deficit, but then where would the foreigners get the money to make up the investment gap in the United States? And they have to. So the way that works out is that the dollar gets stronger. In other words, the stronger dollar offsets the impact of the tariffs. So my imported goods could be French wine, a nice German pair of skis, a Japanese car, whatever it is, Chinese textiles, clothes you buy at Costco from Thailand, whatever it is. If the price of that goes up because of tariffs, the dollar has to get stronger so that the real price doesn't change at all. In other words, my stronger dollar offsets the impact of the tariff. Well, once again, and that's how you adjust this global savings versus trade surplus identity that I described earlier. So bottom line, I'll skip the economics lecture, but the bottom line is tariffs, all things equal, make the dollar stronger because that's how you offset the impact of the tariffs to maintain the foreign trade surplus that gets invested in the United States. So once again, there's a contradiction. Trump says he wants a weaker dollar, but tariffs would actually make the dollar stronger. There are other solutions, including a collapse of investment, so that you close the savings investment gap by shrinking investment, but that would just throw the U.S. economy into a recession. Nobody wants that. So once again, we have Trump calling for a policy, which is tariffs or border tax adjustments on imports.